Good afternoon, everyone. Magandang hapon po sa ating lahat. Welcome po sa ating online orientation of Judiciary e-payment solution for the 40 pilot courts of the RTC pilot courts. My name is Cherry Jean Romano. I work with the Supreme Court MIS office under the Office of Attorney Sherwin Uy, our Deputy Clerk of Court and Chief Technology Officer. It is an honor and privilege to host this afternoon orientation and meet you virtually. This is part of our user adoption series geared towards the realization of the Supreme Court's vision towards a technology-driven judiciary. As you know, as we are all aware, kaka-launch lang po ng ating Strategic Plan for Judicial Innovations, or SPJI 2022 to 2027, which focuses or aims on three outcomes: efficiency, innovation, and access. So the JEPS aims to streamline the process on assessment, payment, and collection of court fees. So the use of the JEPS shall promote greater efficiency, transparency, and accessibility in obtaining the judicial services, bringing the court closer to the Filipino people regardless of their physical location. More of the JEPS and its features will be discussed in details by our SMEs, or subject matter experts, Mr. Dexter Ilagan from the OCA CMO, and Mr. Jason Viernes from the MISO. They will share their secrets in using the JEPS so you too can easily navigate the system. To make sure that we are helping you as best as we can on the JEPS, we have a Q&A section to source out your questions. You can post your questions in our Q&A section as well as in our Viber group chat. I know you have a lot of questions in mind, so feel free to post them and we will try to answer them during our session. Without further ado, I will turn you over to our first speaker, Mr. Jason Viernes.
Thank you, Ma'am CJ. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Jason Viernes and I'm from the MIS office, or the MISO office of the Supreme Court. I'll be providing you a brief overview of what JEPS is, from starting from the public portal, which is the microsite, and on to the admin portal, which our court clerk of courts will be utilizing. And a more detailed presentation of the topics in JEPS will be provided by Sir Dex. Sir Ilagan. But before that, let me first present this teaser of what e-payment is.
Say hello to a more convenient way of paying court fees with e-payment. The Supreme Court has developed the e-payment solution, open to all banks, digital wallets, and other electronic payment channels. It is an application designed to provide the Supreme Court and all the over 2,000 courts in the country options to receive fees and payments digitally from litigants, their counsels, and representatives in a safe, secure, real-time 24/7 basis from anywhere at their convenience. It involves an automated tool that will allow the judiciary personnel to process and manage payment-related activities swiftly and efficiently. The e-payment solution aims to streamline the processes on assessment and payment of court fees, increase accessibility of the public to judicial services, increase transparency and accountability, provide efficient accounting and auditing mechanisms. So, how does it work? A judiciary web facility will be launched that will be used by litigants, their counsels, and representatives, and allow the following: access information, automatically have their fees assessed, and do online payments or get a reference number online corresponding to their online assessment and do over-the-counter payment in the respective courts. Meanwhile, a judiciary e-payment portal on the receiving end will be used by the judiciary staff for accepting over-the-counter payments with online assessments, tracking and reporting of payments from various courts, payments management, electronic audit trails, and financial reporting related to payments. Visit sc.judiciary.gov.ph for more details.
Okay, so as we all know, we have the e-payment portal that will aid us in the collection of fees for our litigants who will be processing or will be filing cases or any court-related matters. So while utilizing the e-payment system of the Supreme Court, we have two ways of accessing it. We have first what we call the public portal, where our litigants can file cases and pay the necessary fees or if cases or other court fees related to the cases they are filing. So the link for the portal is specified here, which is the https://epayment.judiciary.gov.ph. So how do we access this one? So first, when you open this link, you will be provided with a screen that has a button that says go to assessment calculator. Just need to click on this button and it will provide the second screen, which will request details from the litigants. So what type of service are they requesting? Be it filing a case, supplemental pleadings, filing an application or motion for request, or other services. So let's try selecting file cases or file a case. Then the payer type is individual. Click on the next button. Then after which he will select what region he is going to file the case. If he is in region 1 or NCR, he chooses NCR and select the province in NCR, which is Metro Manila. Then what court level is he going to file the case? So if it's for the first level court, he can select first level courts. If it's for the second level courts, you can select the second level courts, which contains the type of court or the regional trial court where we are in. And then we're going to select the station or the location of the RTC. For example, we are in Pasay City. We select Pasay City and then click on the next button. And it will require details of the case to be filed by the litigant. So first, what type or what category is he filing? Is it a civil case? Then the type of civil case, we have here the different civil cases. He just needs to identify which civil case he's going to file. For example, collection sum of money with rep levy. And then he can identify or he can provide a case number if the case is appealed or process ready, or he can simply type NE. There is no number available and particular. Let's just click on the next button. Then the system will require personal information from the litigant. What type of party he is. Is he a defendant? And name, initial, last name, and the most important information that needs to be entered by the litigant is the email address, because it is here where the OTP will.
I'm sorry, Sir Jason. I think you have a problem with your mic.
There's a problem. This one, Sir Darwin.
Yes, okay na po, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay na po. Okay, sorry about that. Nalo ko po yata yung headphones. Okay, so let me continue. So, with the personal information, the most important part of information to be filed by the litigant is the email address. Okay? So here, the email address is where the system will send the OTP, which will be used later on when paying for the necessary fees in the filing of the case. So it is very essential that the email address entered here can be accessed by the litigant or is accessible by the litigant. And then, for example, I select my email address, and then next would be the mobile number. Then click on the next button. So we'll require the user to enter the basis of fees. This is with or without fee exemption. So if with the exemption, he can select yes. So what is the condition why the exemption fee? So it can be an indigent litigant. So specify the number of STF for this one, for example, one, and click on the next button. There's an error in the computation setup. Try this again. Let's try no. Okay, so after the previous grid, we are now going to the next grid, which is the assessment or a preview of the assessment of fees. So here you can see all the details of the amount to be paid. It will be specified here how much is the SAJ, the JDF, the LRF, the MF, the VCF, and the SDF. So it will be totaled as the amount to be paid by the litigant. So let's click on proceed to summary. So here, all the details provided by the litigant will be displayed and will be shown. So if the litigant sees an error in the entry, he can simply select edit details here so that he can either change or replace the error he has entered. Then once everything is okay, he can now confirm. So here you will be seeing that you are requested to verify your email address. This is the email address entered while he is, or the litigant was actually entering his personal details. So let's check the email address. If we receive the OTP. Then click verify. So there, once you have entered the correct OTP, you will be verified and you will be sent to the payment screen where you will be provided with the assessment number of the case file. So this assessment number here is very important to the litigant because he can use this assessment number in actually requesting for information from the court the status of his filed case. So it's very essential that you remind the litigants to take note of the assessment number. So as of now, the filed case is still pending because there is still currently a running balance. The litigant can now proceed to payment. He can choose from these two options here. the InstaPay, Union Bank, and PayGate, which is an online payment of UPay, or he can choose the Fortune Pay. Let's try to select the UPay. Just click on this UPay button here and click continue. Then it will be provided with the details of the payment to be made. So here you can see the reference number is generated automatically and the email address and the amount. Then we have here, as you can see, convenient fee of zero. So later on, this will be discussed by Sir Dex what the convenience fees are. It will depend on the payment option you're going to select. Then click on continue to payment options. So here, under UPay, we have the Union Bank, the InstaPay, and the PayGate. For Union Bank, there is no transaction limit on how much the user can pay online. Thus, the same with the PayGate option. So there's no transaction limit. But when you use the InstaPay option, it has a limit of 50,000 pesos transaction limit. So it is here where the GCash is located. It's under InstaPay. So if you use GCash and paying your fees, you're only limited to 50,000 pesos. Then once you selected type of payment option, and then you can click continue to confirm the page. So as you can see here, there is a convenience fee of 15 pesos. This will be later on discussed by Sir Lex. And then after which a QR code will be generated by the system, wherein the details of this QR code, once clicked using your payment option or e-wallet application, it will generate these details. The receiving bank, the account name, and the reference number. This is your reference number that you will use when you pay using your e-wallet or online banks. Okay, then you just click on continue to confirmation page. Then you will be generated an information wherein it will display here that your payment is being processed. So why being processed? Unless you have paid the required total amount, then your payment will be processed automatically, which then will generate an official receipt. So let's go back to the biller side. Okay, so that's for the portal that the public can use when filing for cases, specifically those litigants who would like to file cases in the court using the e-payment portal. Next, we have the admin portal. So in the admin portal, we have two options of how of logging into the admin portal. We can use the PJ365 provided for us, or we can still continue to use the current email address and password we have provided previously to log into this e-payment portal. So later on, this login screen will be removed, wherein all accounts will be required to log in to e-payment portal using the PJ365. So it would be necessary that those who were provided with the PJ365 email address should use it in logging into the e-payment portal. So let's click login with PJ365. Okay, so as you can see here, you will be provided with a dashboard wherein you can see all the filed cases, the filed applications, and the other services. The case we filed a while back can be found in the filed cases. So just click on the filed cases here. As you can see, this is the filed case I made a while back, which is still pending because I have not yet paid for it. Let's check on the details. You can see here the details of the case filed a while back, which has a status of pending. Kasi nga, hindi pa po nababayaran. Okay, so I guess that's all for me. A more detailed presentation of two sites will be provided for by Sir Dexter. So thank you very much, everyone. And Sir Dex, you may have the floor. Thank you.
Sir Jason, so before anything else, I would like to acknowledge the presence first of my immediate boss, Attorney Andrew Jaukalan, and the auditors present here today. So the auditors will assist me in answering your questions. So, but before you type your questions there, I prepared lots of explanation. So ang intro ko, so from what we discussed the other day with the first level courts, so they brought up their concerns about the implementation of JEPs. The JEPs is about to deploy in all first level courts and 42 RTCs. This is the most awaited moment. Okay, so the JEPs would be beneficial to every one of us. Okay, I'll give you the disadvantages and some disadvantages that we got from the first level courts participants who attended the seminar the other day. Okay, so I just want to thank the Union Bank people who are developing these JEPs for the courts free of charge, and to Attorney Sherwin, Jed Wu is the Deputy Clerk of Court and Chief Management Information Systems Office of the Supreme Court. Before I present you the JEPs microsite and the admin portal, so I'm going to give the comprehensive discussion on those topics. Okay, let me share my screen first. Okay, so the topics that I will discuss today, an overview of the JEPs, so the three categories of the JEPs microsite. The JEPs microsite for the second level courts, JEPs online assessment, and the JEPs online payment. So these are the current pace of the JEPs. So yung online filing, the next phase ng JEPs yun. Okay. So then I'll show you how to generate official receipts. So now official receipts can be computer generated, and the JEPs revised interim guidelines. So why revise? Kasi there was a circular already issued when the 20 pilot courts of the first level courts to pilot test the use of JEPs. Okay, so the JEPs guidelines were provided us. So we revised those guidelines already, and the implementation of JEPs shall be done tomorrow, so October 20. Okay, so to all first level courts and 42 RTC. So the last part of the discussion would be the Q&A. If you have some questions pa after discussing all of these topics, okay, so we're going to answer those questions. Okay, so yung the keynotes in the JEPs revised interim guidelines. Okay, so the JEPs shall be implemented tomorrow, so optional yan. It is just an additional mode of payment for all first level courts and the 42 RTCs. Okay, it would become mandatory, so for 1,000 collections and above. Okay, so December 1, okay, you have plenty of time to prepare. So there are directives then, the circular requiring you to post notices to your court stations and inform the public, your stakeholders, that we would be implementing JEPs. Okay, a mandatory implementation of the use of JEPs. Okay. So whether the JEPs is implemented optional or mandatory, clerks of court are required to send PDF copy of pleadings to cmofmd.oca@judiciary.gov.ph. So the PDF file format is region, comma, court code, JEPs OR number. For example, if you're from region 11, it would be R11, comma, tapos MTC, _dav So this is the court code of MTCC Davao, and comma OR number of JEP, so OR number 1234. Okay, so if you're going to send us the file copy of the JEP through the PJ365 provided to the Fiscal Monitoring Division, so we can filter those emails and we can put that in a folder, so we can do the computer audit to check the computations in the JEPS admin portal compared dito sa pleading submitted. Okay, if 1,000 and below, optional. So more than 1,000 and above, 1,000 and above, yun yung mandatory sa December 1. Okay, pero kahit December 1 na, optional pa yung if the total amount is 1,000 and below. So those collections like yung certification, solemnizations, mga mura lang yung fees doon. Kasi if the party use the JEPS microsite, merong 3 options doon kasi na may convenience fee, may bayad, may additional charges. And may isang payment din na free. Okay, so I'll show you kung ano yung payment na free. Jason already discussed that. Okay, and I'll repeat some of the topics he mentioned. Both the posting of bonds and the payment of fines, even the JEPS is mandatorily implemented, so compulsorily implemented, posting of bonds and payment of fines can be done over the counter or through the offices of the clerk supports. So optional yon. So if the party wants to use the JEPS, so they can. They can use the InstaPay for 50,000 and below. Pwede ang InstaPay. Kung Union Bank, yung UB Online, so walang limit yon. They can use that kung may magpo-post ng bond, kasama na doon yung bond fee. So real-time ang posting noon, mabe-verify agad natin yon. Mabe-verify nyo agad sa court. So yung kung mag-PESONet or PCHC, yun yung hindi namin nire-recommend kasi 1 to 2 days yung verification nun bago ma-confirm yung payment. Okay. So, for courts under direct bank payment option as an additional ano yan, option payment pero preferred mode of payment. Okay. So, whether optional or mandatory, those courts under the direct bank payment option like the RTC Valenzuela pwedeng mag JEPS or direct bank payment pa ang gawin. So kahit December 1 na, yun pa rin yung available mode of payments ng legal fees and other court collections for those court authorized direct bank payments. Okay. So primarily for the use of the litigants, itong JEPS nga as I mentioned for the litigants and party yan. So para convenient sila sa pag-assess and pay ng legal fees and other court collections. But court personnel may use it also, okay? Kung like the what the 20 pilot courts have been doing, they were the ones accessing the JEPS microsite. So, pwede nyo rin gawin yon. Then, you can do nga na kung kayo mag-assess, you can put an extra monitor doon sa window nyo. Tapos kung mag online payment sila and want to use the e-wallets, tapos they can scan the QR code. So pakita nyo lang yung QR code doon sa party so para makapag online payment sila. Okay? So you can do that. So hindi limited yung JEPS sa party litigants. All courts are required to use the JEPS microsite for assessment of filing fees. So included doon sa circular na ilalabas yung revised interim guidelines, all courts. So kaya we invited also some RTC so na to attend the seminar para maging familiar din sila sa assessment ng legal fees kasi required nang gamitin nila yung JEPS microsite in the assessment of filing fees, legal fees and court collections para uniform na yung assessment ng fees. Okay? So, hindi kailangang mag-proceed sila sa payment, pero yung assessment gagamitin nila, yeah, they can print the assessment for the payment or for the order of payment na issue nila or ibibigay nila yan sa party to pay, okay, kung babayad sa court nila. Okay? So, ito yung advantages and disadvantages ng JEPs if implemented. So, yung disadvantages, there are three payment channels doon sa JEPs na may convenience fee. Okay? So, then, pag in-implement ang JEPs, kailangan nyo talaga ng good connect internet connection. So, yung magiging problem nga nung sa provinces, mostly the first level courts, those station doon sa mga rural areas. So, yun magiging problema. Pero, that's why nga the court, nag-issue ang court na nagbibigay ang court ng communication allowance, yung 5,000 na nabibigay sa judges. That's, and we issued circular for that na dapat primarily for the internet connection doon sa court. Dapat magpa-install ng internet doon sa court na yon. So, yun ang gamit primarily ng 5,000 communication allowance. So, kaya magiging compulsory yung gamit ng JEPs because of that one. Kasi hindi, you can reason out din na walang kayong internet. So, dapat handa na kayo, install na kayo ng internet connection sa lugar nyo. Kung there are areas naman talaga impossible magkaroon internet, and you want to be exempted from the use of JEPs, I advise you na sumulat kayo kay court and then ask for an exemption. So you might think that you'll have a hard time comprehending the flow of the system. So naging normal na yung reaction kasi natin na pag may bagong procedure, lalo na about sa change na ganito. Pero hindi, talagang the court is in the process na ng digitization. Okay? Kaya dapat we have to embrace the fact na kailangan natin talaga na move forward na. Okay? So, we have to understand the use and the flow kung paano gagamitin itong JEPs na to. Okay? So, yung sa advantages, okay, yung isa nga, yung una-una, ito yung number one problem natin sa court. So, hindi kasi pare-pareho yung assessment nyo ng filing fees. So, dahil may JEPs na and isa na lang yung computations na susundin nyo, so mag-uniform assessment of filing fees. Okay? Magiging problema na lang dyan yung pag-input ng party kung in-understate na yung amount involved. So, ang control natin doon, if party understated the amount involved doon sa fields provided in the assessment microsite, so you can verify that. Kasi one of the directives doon sa circular, required kayong i-check yung pleadings na ipofile niya, kukompare nyo doon sa binayaran ng tao. Pag na-verify nyo doon sa administrator portal ng JEPs, makikita nyo yung amount involved doon, kung ano yung mga prayer na sa prayer niya sa pleadings and the amounts they encoded there in the system. So kung may underpayment, i-require nyo yung party na magbayad ng deficiency. So kung may deficiency yan, ang work around muna natin dyan is to pay over the counter o magbayad ng muna sa inyo yung deficiency kasi hindi pa available sa JEPs system yung pag makocompute yung deficiency. Okay? So, no need to request for official receipt. So, ito yung number one problem dyan sa property ng mga lower courts. So, laging walang OR. So, hindi mabigyan. So, kaya we issued OCA circular on that matter, yung 05-2021 na pwedeng provisional receipt kasi nauubusan talaga ng OR. Or yung court, wala nang mahiraman na OR sa nearby courts. So, hindi na magiging issue yan. Kung may JEPs na, computer-generated na kasi yung OR. So, hindi na kayo mag-issue manually. So, ang hirap magsulat kaya sa OR. So, iyan din yung problem ng mga auditors. Kapag pangit sumulat yung cashier o clerk of court, lumalabo na yung mga mata ng mga auditors namin. So, hirap na hirap silang basahin yung details ng official receipt nyo. So, pag computer-generated na, ayan, madali na rin sa audit. So, we can do the computer audit na. Okay? So, that's the third advantage of using the JEPs. Okay? Yung CRR and CDR. So, ito yung pinuproblema nyo. Hirap na hirap din kayo mag-accomplish yan. Now, kapag fully deployed na yung JEPs, computer-generated na rin yung CRR and CDR doon sa admin portal ng JEPs. Okay? Ngayon, wala pa yan. Eh, hindi pa available. So, ginagawa pa ng Union Bank yung system na yan. And the statement of unused drawn will be computer-generated also kasi merong silang gagawin din na module doon na you can input the withdrawals. Yung mga disbursement voucher nyo, i-input nyo doon sa JEPs para mag-link yung collections and the withdrawals. By doing that, we can generate statement about withdrawn. doon sa system na yan. Okay? So, yung backup files are safely kept in the SE. So, nakaka-save dito yan kapag sinesend nyo kasi yung data. So, pag natapos yung JEPS, sa subcourt, magpo-provide ang Supreme Court niya ng storage para dito sa mga soft copies ng transaction dito sa JEPS. Okay? So, kung masunugan man kayo, so may natural calamities, meron kayo tayong pagkukunan ng financial records. Yung JEPS nyo, yung reports, copy ng reports, nandito sa system. So, pwedeng mag-computer audit dyan. Okay? Then, yun nga, one option is free of charge. Yun yung Union Bank Online. So, hindi lahat ng option sa JEPS may bayad. So, ito yung libre. Ang Union Bank, so, hindi nyo need na may branch na malapit dyan sa inyo for you to have an account doon sa Union Bank o yung party na inform nyo, dapat pwede sila mag-open ng Union Bank account online. So, dahil yun yung kung ayaw talaga ng parties, you feel bad for the parties na magbayad kung kukuha nga naman ng certifications, 50 pesos plus LRF 60, macha-charge kayo ng 15 plus 25, 40 pesos for the certification. So, 100 pesos na sa certification dahil may convenience fee. So, kung ayaw nilang may convenience fee sa mga petty collections, inform them na mag-open na lang ng Union Bank account. Kasi they can fund din the Union Bank through bank transfer. Kung meron silang GCash din or no, pwede nilang pondohan yung Union Bank account, transfer, bank transfer. Next, yung need to deposit due amount ng collections kasi ito yun ng mga experiences ng ibang collection reports na nawawala yung collection, minsan nadudukutan, nananakawan. So, hindi na mangyayari yun, yung malaking collections. So, lahat nasa banko na, deposited na yan. Okay. Kung hindi natin i-implement itong yung JEPS, di ba, yung ibang courts natin, naka-direct bank payment, so kailangan mag-accomplish ng 6 to 7 deposit slips. Bibigay sa party para ma-deposit yung collections. Diba? So, tedious naman yung procedure na ganon. And hindi din practical kasi pag dineposit, ipapakita yung proof of yung deposit slip sa inyo, you have to verify pa doon sa land bank kung genuine ba yung deposit slip. Why? Kasi nadadaya. So, the validation of the deposit slips can be falsified, diba? Can be forged. So, kapag may nakita pa kasing forged doon na deposit slip, dawit yung clerk of court kung yung cash clerk niya or yung clerk niya lang ang nagdaya ng deposit slip or yung party. So, kasama yung clerk of court doon sa mapapag-investiga. So, kasama siya sa admin case. So, yun yung mga danger na mawawala. So, these are the advantages if we implement the use of JEPS. Okay? Okay? Then, parties, no need to line up. Ito yung pinaka-mahirap dyan. Pipila ka doon sa LBP branches kung direct bank payment. Okay? So, payment channel. So, ito yung sinasabi ko, yung UB Online. Ito yung apat. Instapay, yung PCHC PesoNet, FortunePay. Okay? So, and sa Union Bank, diba? I mentioned, free of charge. Walang convenience fee. Pag sa Fortune Pay, may charge na 50 pesos yan every transaction. Pag PesoNet, pagpasok mo sa JEPS, may 15 pesos plus 25 para sa bank transfer kung gagamit ka ng PesoNet. So, 40 pesos yung add up doon. Like, sa InstaPay, merong 15 pesos sa JEPS plus 15. Like yung GCash, PayMaya, 15 pesos ang charge. Pero yung iba, kung banko yung online banking kayo, 25 pesos ang charge doon. So, 15 plus 25. So, 40 rin kalimitan sa InstaPay. Okay, meron yun nga. Sa InstaPay, na 30 pesos lang, 15 yung other e-wallets, yung charge nila. Okay, so, ang FortunePay may limit yan, na 50,000. Yung PCHC, wala. Ang disadvantage nga lang dito pag PCH or PesoNet, kahit walang limit, delay naman yung posting yan. So, yung confirmation ng payment, it would take 1 to 2 days bago ma-confirm yung payment. So, hindi nyo makikita doon sa administrator portal nyo na tag as paid siya, naka-pending yan for 1 to 2 days. Pag PesoNet or PCH ang ginamit ng parting pambayad. Yung InstaPay, ganun din. May 50,000 limit. Pero ano naman to? Real time. So pagkabayad mo, mga few minutes, ang pinakamatagal nga namin. Minsan, pag talagang maraming transaction, umabot ng 10 minutes, 30. So meron pang naka-experience ng matagal-tagal kasi may error pa sa system. Expected naman natin yung ganito during sa pilot implementation. Pero ang ideal kasi dito sa InstaPay, real time, so dapat 1 to 3 minutes, meron na. Okay? Pero kung may magka-problem naman na delay, so we can inquire about the status of the payment, we can ask the Union Bank people to verify the payment. So yun ang nangyayari dyan kung may delay posting. Okay? So yung Union Bank, walang limit. Kaya kung may cash ban post, may magpo-post ng cash ban, ng bail bonds, tapos sarado na yung banko or sarado na yung court, so pwedeng gumamit ng JEPs. Kung ayaw nang may service charge, so they can use Union Bank. Kung mga ilang 100,000 mahigit, usually sa drugs cases, malalaki yung bail bonds. So they can use the JEPs using itong UB Online. Dapat meron silang Union Bank account. Okay? So yung yun nga, yung the UB branch is in the area is not essential kasi pwedeng mag-open ng Union Bank online. Okay, so ito yung payment channels available sa loob ng JEPS microsite. Okay? So if JEPS would not be mandatory, so marami kasing nag-re-request na huwag gawing mandatory dahil mahihirapan. Kaya na-move sa December 1 na i-mandatory yung use ng JEPS. Pero kung pagdating ng December 1, baka ma-convince si mga bossing namin na hindi i-mandatory yan. So, ang mangyayari niyan, if JEPS would not be mandatory, i-re-recommend ng auditors yung direct bank payment. Okay? So, kailangan nyo mag-accomplish ng 6 to 7 deposit slip para mag-deposit yung party doon sa land bank diretso. Kasi starting December 1 nga, so the collection, yung handling of cash na malaki, ililimit na yan. Dapat, kung yun nga ang suggestion, if more than 1,000, direct bank payment na ang gagawin. Okay? Ang mangyayari, so pipila na naman sa land bank yan. So, mahabang pila. So, you have to regularly communicate with the LBP branch where you maintain your local accounts. Kasi pag ang party nagbayad direct bank payment, isasubmit sa inyo yung deposits. So, you have to confirm the deposits made. So, you have to communicate. You have to call the LBP branch kung valid ba yung deposit slip. So, why we're doing that? Kasi si Chief Justice Alexander Diosmundo personally questioned us na why do we allow clerks of courts to hold collections na malalaki? Kasi like what happened sa Makati, so, di ba may 200,000 plus na hawak yung clerk of court, nagbibilang lang siya, lumabas, biglang nawala na yung collection. So may kumuha. So yung case na yun, so the Chief Justice asked us, bakit ina-allow natin ng OCA ng bakit nakaka-handle ng ganung kalaking amount. So ang suggestion ni Chief, hindi payagan na magkaroon dapat ng threshold amount, limit na pwedeng hawakan ang accountable officer kahit during the day, hindi pwedeng within 24 hours deposit. Ayaw ni Chief yun. Gusto niya pag may malaking amount, deposit agad. So ito yung naisip namin na hindi na talaga i-allow maghawak ng collections ang accountable officers ng malalaki. So, pag malalaking collections, diretso sa banko ang deposit. Okay? And, pag direct bank payment, you'll have to verify the deposit slip. Nga, anong question? Doon sa concerned branches and or valid. Identifying last of deposits, whether forged or not, is really very hard. Kaya, yung unang months na implement yung direct bank payment sa and some in CR court, so marami talagang nahirapan doon yung parties, pumipila ng matagal, malayo yung pinipila nila bago sila makabayad. So yan, if JEPS hindi magiging mandatory sa December 1, may be recommended sa OCA para ma-implement na lang. Okay? So kung ito nga, yung kung ma-forge yung deposit slip, kasama yung clerk of court doon sa investigation, sa admin case. So, maraming danger pag direct bank payment ang gagawin. So dapat ma-encourage nyo yung public na use JEPS. So hindi naman lahat kasi may bayad sa JEPS. Yun nga, ang Union Bank, pwede nyo advise sila na mag-open ang Union Bank account, right? Kahit online. So, ito na, yung JEPS microsite. So, may three categories dito. So, legal fees are categorized into three. Okay, dito sa assessment of filing fees for filing of cases. Dito yung kung magfa-file ng cases, dito, ito yung category ng i-choose. Kaya sa loob ng nitong microsite na to, if you click this black button, bago kayo mag-start, pipili kayo sa tatlong to kung anong payments ang babayaran nyo. Kung sa second category ba, yung mga filing applications and motions, request. Kung sa third category ba. Okay? So, ano ba yung mga fees na nandito? Okay? So, ito yung JEPS microsite. Okay? Ang ito yung web address niya, epayment.judiciary.gov.ph. So, sa first category, yan, ito yung cover ng filing of a case. So, civil cases, special proceedings, so lahat ng ipafile ng criminal cases with civil liability, intellectual property rights cases, commercial corporate cases, kahit sa even in the appellate courts or tertiary courts, kasama din dito yan. Nakategorize din yung fees nila dito sa tatlo. So, para to sa judiciary, sa lahat ng judiciary, itong JEPS. Okay. So, yung second category, you would find fees like the fees for performance of marriage application for to solemnize a marriage, yung extrajudicial foreclosure, notary commission. So, lahat to, yung posthumous cash ban, itong lahat ng to na merong LRF. So, itong dalawang to, may LRF na collection yan. Okay? Pag walang LRF, nasa third category yon. So, yung mga serving ng summons and copy of complaint, may mangyayaring mangongolekta ng there are instances na so ready comments na meron pang additional tao pala kailangan padala ng summons, so mag-additional summons fee or mag-i-issue ng another summons, so ito yung gagamitin sa third category. Okay? So, kung mag-i-issue ng subpoena, so may subpoena fee. Okay? So, kasama dito sa third category, yung mga court fines, eh, di ba? Pag fines doon sa mga administrative cases, violation ng rules, so contempt proceedings, sa judge i-deposit yun. So, makikita nyo dito pag magbabayad ng fine yung tao, they can access, use these JEPS. Okay, court fines. Pagbebenta ng notary book, nandito rin yun. Okay, yung TSN fees, so yan yun. Kung TSN fees, pwede rin dito bayaran. Okay. So, itong basis natin dito na bakit nasa two categories to na may LRF. So, pursuant dun sa OCA Circular 106-2021, the OCA Circular categorized those fees as filing fee. Okay? So, pag filing fee, remember, may LRF yun. Okay? The filing fee could be filing fee related dun sa filing ng case or filing fee related sa filed application or mga notices, motions, request. Okay? So, papasok na tayo sa loob ng JEPS microsite. And kasunod nito, meron akong sample video din paano mag-assess and mag-print ng generate ng official receipt to proceed in the online payment. Type in the web address of the JEPS microsite, that is epayment.judiciary.gov.ph. Okay, let's check out the JEPS microsite. Okay? Open the web browser and type in the web address of the JEPS microsite, that is epayment.judiciary.gov.ph. So, the web address of the administrator portal of the JEPS is already saved here. So, we don't need the /admin/. So, we're going to remove that one. Otherwise, the web page will take us to the administrator portal of the JEPS. So, the web address of the microsite is this one only. Okay? Press enter. And now we're here in the JEPS microsite. So, the JEPS microsite is primarily for the use of the litigants or parties. Okay? If they want to know the assessed fees sa cases that they're going to file, they can use this one. So they have only to press the black button. So go to assessment calculator. Or Clear Support can use this also. Okay. So kung you want to make sure na the fish are properly assessed, pwedeng kayo ang mag-accomplish nitong JEPS microsite, oh, to input the details dito, yung amount involved, kung tama yung ilalagay based doon sa pleadings na ipofile ng court. Okay, so we're done discussing about the three categories here. So we're going inside the JEPS microsite. Okay, the JEPS microsite has 7 windows. So the first one here, so we need to input the service type. So we're going to choose which category are we going to assess. Okay, so the first category about filing of cases, kasama yung supplemental pleadings and answers. If there are cases already filed and they want to file a supplemental pleadings, dito pa rin papasok yun. So to assess the additional filing fees, kung meron, okay, the system will determine the deficiency, okay, kung merong sobra or kulang. Pero yung computation na yon hindi pa provided dito sa current version ng JEPS na to. So, underdeveloped pa yung formula na yon. Pero lahat ng cases, civil cases, criminal, environmental, family court cases, nandito na yan. Lahat, pati Sharia cases. Okay, we already provided here in the JEPS microsite. Okay? The second category about filing of, yung filing an applications, motions or requests. Dito yung mga solemnization of marriage, then motion for postponement, then request for issuance of clearance. Okay, the third category, ito yung walang LRF. Okay, fees na walang LRF. So let's check first muna yung third category. Okay, then we need to provide the payer type. So there are two options, individual and juridical. Pag juridical, company ang nag-file o nababayad. Okay, nag-assist. Okay, so I'll choose individual. Then, region. So, we're going to provide the region nung court na we want to file a case or we want to pay the legal fee. Okay, so I want to choose the NCR. Okay, pag NCR, automatic Metro Manila lang ilalabas niya. Okay, so ang courts na nasa NCR, ibibigay niya ito. Supreme Court, Court of Appeals, Court of Tax Appeals, Sandigan Bayan. So, mayroong first level na NCR, second level NCR. So, pupunta ako sa second level. Okay, court type, RTC. Pag sa NCR, RTC lang ang nandun. Okay? So, lahat ng RTC sa NCR nandito. Ito yung mga kompleto yung bank accounts. Lalabas yung court station dito if complete yung FIDO account and may separate STF account yung court. Kung wala yung court station nyo dito, it means may kulang kayong bank account. So, kung hindi na-provide pa dito sa system yon, you have to give us the copy of your passbook para may input namin dito sa JEPS Administrator Portal yung details ng bank accounts nyo. Okay? So, if I choose naman the province or region, like Region 7, okay? So, Cebu, sa second level, RTC. So, bakit wala ang Cebu? Oo, ano. Okay. So, if I choose Region 4, okay? So, Batangas, second level, so, RTC, so, lahat ng RTC sa Batangas, nandito. Yun, lahat ng kompleto yung bank accounts. Okay? Pero, pag pumunta ako sa Region 12, like Maguindanao, okay, second level. So, dalawa yung option dito, RTC and Sharia District Court. So, that may second level ang Sharia Court, Sharia District. Okay, so, mayroong mga cases din dapat, yung mga court station dapat lalabas dito. Kaso, mayroong mga Sharia District Courts, kulang pa yung FIDO account nila. STF lang sila meron, kaya hindi mag-a-appear dito. So, pag walang FIDO account, hindi mag-a-appear sa JEPS. Okay? So, kung RTC, lahat ng RTC sa Maguindanao makikita. Okay, so let's choose Cotabato and let's try. Okay, so itong court commission on all money excluding cash fund coming into the clerk's hands. So ito yung may deposit na pera kasama yung court commission under section 7K. So ito yung court commission na extrajudicial foreclosure, yung sa bidding, yung highest bid amount, i-deposit sa court. Ito pag actual collection, ito yung pipiliin. So yung i-deposit sa court. Pag hindi i-deposit sa court, ito lang, commission lang ang babayaran. So constructive collection. So no money to be deposited. Okay? So yung ito, so if magko-consign sa court na exempt person yung magko-consign, so walang fee dito, yung pera lang for deposit sa fiduciary fund. So yun yung bilhin. So execution of writ of attachment fee, sa writ of possession, sa writ of left living, eh, meron tayo dyan. So including the fines imposed as penalty for a crime committed, except drugs cases, yung sa mga criminal cases na fines, court fines. So ito yung choose. So pero kung administrative fines sa SAGE, ito yung pipiliin. Okay, kung sa drugs cases, fines sa drug cases, ito, okay? So meron din dito, kung may bibili na notary book, ito yung choose nyo. Okay, so yung mga other fees dito, notary fees, notice of garnishment fee. So yung other services, yung mga wala dito na 200 yung fee. Basta wala dito, so ito yung other service fee yung mag-apply, 200 pesos. Okay, so posting and publication fee. Pa. So yan, yung subpoena fee ito. Yung TSN fee, before appeal and after appeal. So pag ito yung chinose, yung 2/3 sa fee do i-deposit. Okay, yung 1/3 sa JDF. So yun ang mangyayari dito. Okay. So, kung before appeal, 20 pesos per page. Then, after appeal, yung 10 pesos per page. So, yun yun. Second category naman tayo. Let's check. MCR. Okay, ito yung available sa second category. Accreditation of newspapers and periodical sa appeal fee for accused appellant. Dalawa yan. So, pag appeal fee, pag sa criminal cases, ito walang mediation fee. Itong appeal fee, may mediation fee ito, ha, for civil case. Itong appeal fee for accused appellant, walang mediation fee. So, yung 3,000 lang plus LRF. Ito, merong 3,000 plus 1,000 MF plus LRF. Okay, so yan yung mga pinokolekta. Ito, certification under Rule 138, yung law student practice, yung 200 pesos na certification fee. So, clearance certification na 50 plus LRF. So, lahat ito may LRF. Okay, Commission as Notary Public, AF. So, motion for postponement. Nandito, yung pag-post ng cash or cash bond or supersedious bond by an exempt person, walang fee to, di-deposit lang sa fiduciary fund. So, ito naman yung may bond. Pag may magpapiansa, ito yung i-choose. Posting of cash bond or yung may mag-supersedious bond. So, 500 bond fee yan plus cash bond. Okay, so yung posting of surety bond, okay, ito fee lang yung kukolektahin dito. So, provisional remedy fee, so, to 500 per provisional remedy. Kung may TRO or ito injunction. Okay, so reception of evidence, ito yung 500. For reception of evidence, the solemnization of marriage. Okay, so yung first category, so ito yung mga cases na kinuha namin sa inyo, so we categorize the cases. Diba, kung civil cases, kung special proceedings. Okay, so sa cadastral cases, yan marami. Kung pipiliin yan, nandito lahat yung 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So, 10 types ng cases, ng cadastral cases nandito. So, mayroong iba-iba lang yung pangalan, yung tawag. Pero nandiyan lahat yon. So, magpo-fold dito lahat ng cadastral cases. Okay? So, pag civil cases, so, nandiyan yun, yung admiralty cases. So, ang admiralty cases, meron lang courts na designated dyan, yung Manila, ITC Manila, kung saan yung may mga port, may port area, sa Cebu, sa Mindanao, meron. Okay, sa Region 3, meron din port area doon. Okay, so yung collection of sum of money, we have five choices here. Ito plain sum of money, ito yung collection of sum of money and replibin, with or without provisional revenues. Pag collection of sum of money and replibin, so yung amount involved and yung value ng property, i-consider yon sa pag-compute ng legal, ng filing fees. Okay? Pag ito naman naka-or, choose ng system kung anong mas mataas, yung sum of money, money involved, amount involved, or yung value ng property. Okay? Pag may provisional remedies naman, so ito yung pipiliin. Okay, pag collection of sum of money with replibin, so pareho lang dito yon, ito walang provisional remedies. Ito pwedeng meron or walang provisional remedies. So pareho lang yung computation ng dalawang to. Pero kung may provisional remedies na idadagdag, choose this one. Okay. So consignation case, yan yon, jurisdictional yung niyang depende sa amount involved. Okay, so in capable of kunyari estimation, 2,000 lang yung filing fee dyan. On other actions not involving property, so 2,000 din yan. Okay? Yung permissive counterclaim, meron ng sariling field. So ito yung real actions. Okay? Or action reivindicatoria, or action publiciana, or recovery of possession. So dyan papatak yun. So iba-ibang tawag ng real actions, dito papatak yun. So it fall under this category. So kung merong provisional remedies, choose this one. Okay? Kung replibin or recovery of possession with or without damages, yeah. So, I advise na mag-utilize nitong microsite para maging familiar kayo sa categories cases dito. And there, so, itong revival of judgment, so, ang revival of judgment depende sa new cause of action. So, pursuant doon, kinlarify yan under OCA Circular 36-2018. Okay, so, ang new cause of action pwedeng maging capable or pwedeng incapable. So, pag capable ang new cause of action sa case, survival of judgment, so pwedeng first level yan or second level. Pero kung incapable yung new cause of action, sa inyo na, sa ITC. Okay. So, kung yan, commercial cases, so criminal cases, nandito yung stapan, other criminal cases. Okay. Kung family court cases, so yan yun, yung annulment of marriage, lahat ng pinafile sa family courts, nandito. Okay. Kung special civil actions, ito yung nandiyan, yung expropriation cases, yung judicial foreclosure, partition, quieting of title. So yung apat na yon, real actions yung computation niyan. So lahat to, yung apat na yon. So ito yung ibang mga special civil actions. Okay? So special proceedings, hindi na lahat yun, pati yung ADR, yung mga case ADR dyan, so election protest, yung recognition of foreign judgment, so yung petition for issuance of writ of habeas corpus, okay, so may computation na yan. Pag itong real property taxes, 1,000 lang yan kung yung assessor's office kasi nagpa-file yan. Okay, so yung itong mga to, yung mga exempt, okay, yung mga nagpa-file, so 1,000 lang yung babayaran dito. Okay, so try natin kung real action, kung may with or provisional remedies. Okay, so you can put anything here kung wala pa yung case number. So hindi pa napafile yan, no case numbers. Kung application ID, ID 123456, so lagay nyo anong title ng case. Kung lagay nyo real actions, kung annulment of title, against kung sinong kinakasuhan nyo. Okay, si Jan Doe again. Or si Juan de la Cruz. Okay. The next. So, plaintiff. Party type. Tapos yung personal details nyo. Ito yung importante. You have to provide their email address. Kasi dito isa-send yung OTP para makapag-proceed kayo sa online payment. Okay. Then, your cellphone number. Okay. So, you have to choose kung exempt ba o hindi. So, ito yung question nyo. Na paano pag yung party kinlik? Yes. Pag ganyan, nag-yes ang chunos niya, 1,000 lang ang babayaran niya or STF lang kung ilang STF ang babayaran. So, usually, isa lang. So, paano natin makokontrol yan? Yung OR kasi, pag pinaresent sa inyo ng party, tapos binayaran niya STF lang, they're saying na exempt sila. So, kung hindi naman pa yung exemption kasi, kailangan may order pa ng kodyanda at mag-submit sila ng requirements. Okay, kung ma-deny sila na hindi pala sila exempt, so, i-require nyo magbayad ulit ng additional, yung deficiency. Okay? So, kung no naman ang chinus, so, if the party should provide or the one who's accomplishing the microsite, the assessment, online assessment forms, yung provide yung assessed value ng property, kung 100, so, nandyan yung cut personal value, kung 350, okay? So, yung fair market value nandito sa baba. Papunta dito sa baba yan. So, kung 200, okay, magkano litigation fee, attorney's fee, okay? So, total damages pa. So, kung may other claims pa, 5,000. Or, kung wala naman, pwedeng zero yan. Okay? So, kung may provisional remedies, kung ilan yung provisional remedies, dalawa or isa lang, ibayad din yan. Or, kung wala naman, pwedeng zero. Okay? So, lagyan natin ng isa. Okay? Defendant, dalawa. Tingnan natin dalawa. Spouses. Pag spouses, kasi tig-isa. Okay, so next natin. So, yan yon. Automated na yung computation. So, ang basis ng filing fee ito, 450. So, kung gusto nyo yung reviewin, proceed to summary. Pag may nakita kayo mali pala, sabi natin, yung damages pala, 500,000, hindi pala 50,000 lang. So, pwede kayong mag-back. Back. Palitan natin yung damages. 500,000, dagdag natin ng zero. So, yung 450, ngayon, 900 na. Okay? So, lumaki na yung babayaran niya, 17,055. So, ganun yan. Then, proceed, kailangan mag-proceed to summary. Then, pag na-review nyo, okay na yan. Confirm yung, i-confirm natin yung payment. Poprompt yan ng, magsisend na yung JEPS doon sa email ad na pinrovide nyo. So, pag input nyo yung, nung OTP, okay, diretso na ka sa online payment. So, punta kayo sa email. So, I provided a video tutorial using the microsite na may complete payment and OR generation. So, I'll play it. Okay?
Okay, so, let's start the assessment. So, let's click the go to assessment calculator. And ito, so I'll choose other services. So, para mura lang yung babayaran. And I encourage also, utilize the use of JEPS para familiar kayo dito sa JEPS. Kung magtuturo kasi kayo doon sa party, sa pay, mga magbabayad sa court nyo, dapat familiar kayo sa JEPS. Ay, nasa isa sa directive doon sa circular regarding guidelines dito sa implementation ng JEPS na responsibility nyo na inform yung public or turuan sila kung paano gamitin yung JEPS. So, yung iba namang courts, ang ginagawa nila, sila yung nag-assess dito, silang gumagamit ng microsite, then binibigyan nila sa party yung assessment number para bayaran or iscan yung QR code para bayad. You can do that also. Okay? So, let's complete the details dito. So, choose individual. Then, ako sa Region 4. Ako dito, sa Batangas, first level. Okay? So, dito, sa lugar namin. Choose ko yan. And, ang babayaran ko para yung pinakamura, the filing copies of document fee, section 8K. Pangalan ko na lang ilagay ko, ang case na, certification lang yan. Kung anong remarks yung ilalagay, pwedeng ilagay dyan, or yung name ko. Okay. So, complete natin yung details. So, again, I repeat, dapat ang ilalagay nyo dito ang email ad, yung tama, kasi dyan ipapadala yung OTP para to proceed doon sa online payment. I click the next button, then ilang number of pages, isa lang. Okay, next. So, yan. O, mura lang yung babayaran ko. 10 piso, 10 pesos. So, yung automatic na yung computation dyan. Nakasegregate na yung 40 pesos, 30 cents. para doon sa SAJ and 960 sa JDF. So, hindi na kayo mahirapan mag-compute kung 2 pages yun, well, 10 pages. So, mabilis na yung system, automatic na, 100 piso. Okay? Pero hindi ko babayaran yan. So, 100, sayang yung 90. One page na lang ang gagawin ko dyan. Para 10 pesos lang, okay? So, proceed to summary. Kailangan pumunta kayo sa summary para i-check nyo, re-review yan. Review nyo yan, number of pages, kung tama, kung okay na, confirm payment. And yan, mag-pop up yung verify your email address. Ibig sabihin, nag-send na ang JEPS sa email ad na tinipe nyo doon sa system ng OTP number. So, punta ngayon kayo doon sa inbox, sa email address nyo. Kunin yung OTP. Okay, so ito, meron na akong na-receive from no reply e-payment. So, Philippine Judiciary e-payment. So, ito yung OTP number. Okay, so 590-040. 590-040. Input then, verify it. Ayan, so pag tinanggap yung OTP, dadalhin na kayo dito sa proceed to payment window. Okay, so pending yan, ang status pending kasi hindi pa binabayaran. Yan yung makikita nyo rin sa admin portal. So, ang kailangan nyo gawin, ikakopy nyo itong assessment number. Tandaan nyo yan. Okay? Save nyo yan. Dahil dito magbe-verify, pwede nyo i-retrieve yung assessment na to doon sa admin portal para i-review kung tama ba yung binayaran. Yung sinasabi ko, yung i-review nyo, yung proof of payment. Itong JEPS OR, kung may parting nagbayad using JEPS, papakita yung JEPS OR, kukunin nyo itong assessment number, i-type nyo dito sa track case number. Click nyo yan, i-input nyo itong assessment number na to para ma-search nyo itong payment na to. Okay, so ang gagawin ko dyan, kakopy ko to, save ko doon sa proceed to payment tayo. Proceed to payment. So, may dalawang options ngayon dito. Ito, meron pa dapat itong credit card payment. So, wala pa yon. Itong UPay, ito yung isang option, UPay. Under UPay, nandyan yung Union Bank, yung InstaPay, and itong PesoNet, itong PCHC. So, yung PesoNet or PCHC, isa lang yon. Ito yung more than 50,000 kung ang babayaran, dapat through PCHC yung i-choose. Kung FortunePay, so, another yan, may convenience fee ding charge dito. So, ang gagawin ko, piliin ko to. So, naka-highlight ngayon itong UPay option. Then, click continue. Okay. So, ito yung total na babayaran. So, zero ang convenience fee dyan. Kung UPay ang malalaman nyo kung magkano yung charge na lalabas dito, depende sa wallet or sa e-wallet na pipiliin natin sa InstaPay, kung anong bangko, kung GCash ba, PayMaya, or UPay, or Union Bank. Okay, so, next ko yan, continue to payment options. Okay, so, nasa number to menu na tayo. So, ito yon yung under doon sa UPay, ito yung tatlong pagpipilian, yung Union Bank, InstaPay, and PesoNet. So, kung wala kayong Union Bank account, meron kayong GCash, PayMaya, or Land Bank account, or Metro Bank BPI, so through InstaPay. Click nyo yan. So, mapapansin nyo, pag kinilik nyo yon, nadagdagan ng 15 pesos ang babayaran nyo. Instead na 10, naging 15, 25 na. Okay, so yan yung sa InstaPay. Kaya ang gagawin ko dyan, hindi yan ang choose ko. Balik ako doon sa, punta ulit ako doon sa payment option. Ang pipiliin ko, Union Bank. So, yung Union Bank, walang charge. 10 pesos lang. Okay, so click. So, pag-click next, so yun pa rin yung babayaran, 10 pesos. Okay, babantayan lagi itong amount na nandito sa total na babayaran. Kasi kung InstaPay yan, magiging 25. Hindi, wag 10 pesos lang ang babayaran nyo. Pag 10 pesos lang binayaran nyo, short yun. Hindi i-consider na valid payment ng system yon. Partial payment ang ilalagay niya, hindi fully paid. Okay? Pero dahil wala akong service charge, 10 pesos lang yung babayaran ko. Okay na ako dito. And I click the check button here. Then, continue to Union Bank Online. So, 10 pesos lang yung babayaran ko. Okay, so i-display na ngayon ang system. Pag sa Union Bank, kailangan input dito yung username and password. Enter your one-time password. So, receive, click nyo kung receive OTP via SMS kung anong naka-enroll doon sa Union Bank app nyo na number. Okay, sinabi natin na yung OTP. So, input ko yung OTP. Input 2. Okay, then, pag na-input yung OTP, babayaran na. Okay, so meron akong 2,000 pa pala dito sa Union Bank. Okay, so choose nyo kung marami kayong bank account number, account dito naka-enroll sa Union Bank app nyo. So, pipiliin nyo kung anong account yung gagamitin nyo. So, authorize. Okay, so ito na yung proof of payment. Okay, pwede natin screenshot yan. So hindi pa ito yung OR ng JEPS. Hindi pa ito yung JEPS OR. So, makikita nyo lang yung nandito yung assessment number para i-verify yung payment na to. So, go back to biller site para makuha natin yung OR. Okay, yan. Sabi niya, view official receipt. Okay? So, view natin yung official receipt. Click it. Yan. Yan yung official receipt. So, yan yung 10 pisong binayaran ko. So, yan yung format ng OR ngayon. Malaki ang size niyan. So, makikita niyo kung sinong clerk report. At sinus ko, I paid dito sa Lemery. Okay, Lemery, MCT si Lemery Egoncillo, si Ma'am Mary Ann. Ineto yung clerk of court. So, nandyan yung pangalan niya, na-appear. So, ito yung isasubmit ng party sa inyo. Once na-submit sa inyo, i-verify nyo ngayon payment. So, nandoon sa rule or guidelines ng JEPS yan sa circular. So, kailangan i-confirm nyo yung payment dahil baka pineke lang itong OR na to. So, titingnan nyo sa JEPS admin portal yon. So, tuturuan ko later kayo kung paano nyo i-confirm itong payment. Ngayon, I'll teach you how to print the OR. So, kung paano nyo ipiprint to, mas maganda, i-save nyo muna. May option dyan, save official receipt. Okay, pag kinilik nyo yan, automatic yung naka-default yan, doon sa magsisave yan, doon sa download folder. Pero sa akin, pinalitan ko yung option dito. So, kontrolado ko kung saan ko gustong i-save yan. Okay. Pero kung sa inyo hindi nyo pa modify yung settings dyan, ang default na ang downloading is doon sa dito sa downloads folder. Okay? Kung gusto ko rin dyan sa download folder, dyan ko ilalagay. Okay? How are going to print the OR? Okay? Open nyo yung OR. So, yan yon. So, kanina I said na tuturuan ko kayo paano pag reduce ng size nito. Kasi pag pinirint nyo to, ang size nito, whole bond paper. Okay? So, ito, PDF file na to, kaya pag inopen nyo yan, magpuprop ako, I use the Microsoft Edge, kaya gusto ko itong Microsoft Edge, kasi pwede itong mag-open ng PDF file. So, ang kagandahan din nito, pwede kong screenshot yung mga portion dito, like right-click ako, so, web capture. Click yung web capture. Pwede kong i-capture yung, i-copy to. I-paste ko dun sa ibang file. O, yun yung maganda dito sa Microsoft Edge. So, maraming gamit. Okay, so, pag-print natin, paano ipiprint? So, click nyo lang itong icon na printer. Okay, ito. You can modify the settings of your printer. So, depende kung anong printer ang gamit nyo. So, gamit ko dito yung Brother. May option dito na ito yung size. So, papalitan nyo yan kung maliit, malaki. So, dito nyo makokontrol yung size ng papel na pagpiprintan nyo. Okay, pwede nyo modify yan. Or, pwede nyo naman liitan yan dito sa pages per sheet. So, ang gusto ko, half lang ng coupon band yung magagamit. So, pag pinrint ko, ang gagawin ko dito, dalawa, 2, para 50%. Dalawang OR ang pwede ko ma-print sa isang coupon band. So, maliit yan. So, magagamit ko pa yung half sa pag-print ng another OR. Okay? So, yan yung how to reduce yung copy ng OR. Okay, so click the print button. Ito, I'll show you naman kung InstaPay naman ang gagamitin nating pambayad. Okay, so let's see the difference. Okay, so proceed. Then another verify. Okay, so let's try InstaPay. Proceed to payment under sa UPay pa rin. Okay. Then, ito, 10 pesos yung ginawa ko ulit. Another 10 pesos. So, sa ibang card station ako magbabayad. Continue to payment. So, instead ng Union Bank, gamitin ko yung InstaPay. Okay, para magamit yung QR code. So, ngayon, 25 pesos na yung babayaran ko kasi may convenience fee. Okay, so hindi lang 10 pesos yung babayaran sa isang certification, plus 15, 25 na. Yung dapat. So, continue. Kung gusto nyo makita yung accredited dito, kung ano yung mga bank or e-wallet na available sa InstaPay, click nyo to. Pwede nyo check dito sa view na list kung ano yung pwede. So, yan yung mga banko. Okay? All Bank, Asia United Bank, so BPI, Land Bank, Metro Bank, Paymaya, Philippine Savings, yan, Queen City Development, RCBC, Robinsons Bank. Okay. So try ko continue to confirm. So 15 pesos, click ko yung... Yan, ito, i-display na ng system. Ito. Ang gagamitin nyo lang mas mabilis, itong QR code. I-open nyo lang yung sa mobile app nyo, yung QR code scanner nyo doon sa loob ng e-wallet nyo, yung online banking app. I-scan nyo to. Kung hindi naman available yung QR code, kung hindi pwede sa GCash scan to, punta lang kayo sa option ng GCash yung bank payment. So, itatype nyo itong Philippine Judiciary sa account name, then yung account number na nandoon. So, ito yung reference number. Ito type nyo. Then, ikikihin nyo yung amount na 25 pesos kung manual input ang gagawin. Pero kung scanning ang QR code, automatic 25 yung ibibill sa account nyo yan. So, ganun lang yan. Kung na-scan na, nabayaran nyo na, click continue to confirmation page. Okay? So, click confirm. Hahanapin nyo na ngayon yung proof of payment. So, gaya ng ginawa natin kanina, go to biller site para makita natin yung OAP. Okay, so ganun yung difference kung Union Bank or InstaPay. Okay.
Okay, so that's how we use Jeffs in the payment online payment. Okay? So ang example I chose yung payment of certification kasi cheap, the cheapest item doon sa Jeffs microsite. So we have still 30, 25 minutes. So, i-continue natin the other directive doon sa circular. Ito. So, ang number one dyan, you are required to verify your bank accounts doon sa Jeffs admin portal. So, you have to confirm yung natama yung bank accounts na nakaprovide doon. Kasi all payments na for fiduciary fund and SDF, doon i-remit ng Union Bank kung anong account na nandoon. So, you have to verify the account na nandito sa Jeff. So, how are you going to do that? So, I prepared also the tutorial video for this one. Ito yung kasunod. Okay? So, huwag muna kayong matutulog dyan. Okay, how to verify your account numbers or bank account numbers. So, first you're going to do, okay, open your web browser, then go to the administrator portal of the Jeffs. So type epayment.judiciary.gov.ph/admin/. Okay, enter. Okay, this is the front view of the Jeffs administrator portal. Then, log in your accounts, those accounts we provided. And by this time, dapat activated na yung mga accounts nyo. Otherwise, hindi nyo magagamit dito sa Jeffs Administrator Portal. Okay? So, I'm using my personal account.
Then click login. Okay. And it will take you to the dashboard of your CourtStation. Okay. So, paano nyo i-confirm na tama yung CourtStation nyo? If you point your cursor dito sa name nyo, makikita nyo ilalabas yung CourtStation nyo. So, I'm COC from ITC Manila. So, proxy muna ako kay Attorney Jen. Okay. Wala pa si ma'am. Nasa labakasyon. Okay. So, ang ID ko is from ITC Manila. So, you're going to verify also your CourtStation. Kung mali yan, so inform nyo ako kami sa FMD para i-correct namin kung saan namin kayo ilalagay na CourtStation. Okay? So we're going to verify your accounts. Yung mga bank accounts ng FIDO and STF. So punta, you click the maintenance menu here. Then the courts menu. Then kung saan level nyo. Okay, nandito lahat ng judiciary courts. First level, second level, and the tertiary courts. Okay. So, I'm looking for the accounts of the ITC Manila, kung tama siya. Then, the court type funds, this should be court station. So, this will be renamed to court station. Okay, click this court type funds, then input the RTC because we're looking for the RTC Manila. So, saan yung RTC Manila? Sa NCR. Okay? So, pag-click nyo ng Metro Manila, lalabas niya lahat ng RTC dito sa NCR. So, makikita nyo yung bank accounts nyo dito. So, yung Manila, okay? Pag wala dyan, ibig sabihin, hindi. It doesn't mean na wala. So, tingnan nyo yung table dito, yung ilang window ba yan? So, there are two tables there. Windows. Two windows. So, yung Manila siguro. Ito. Yung Manila pala. Andito. Okay? So, sino Attorney Jen? So, kung wala dito kasi, you can click the other sheet. So, makikita nyo yung ibang court stations there. Kung kailangan nyong magpadala ng STF deposit sa kanila, so you can check this window also. Okay, magagamit niyo yun sa pag-deposit ng STF collections. Okay. So, here, I'll verify your STF account. So, yung una, STF account, then FF account. So, itong kay ma'am, so, hindi pa na-provide yung account name for FF. Blanco pa, and account name for STF. So, kailangan nating i-provide yan. So, we need a copy of the passbook or bank statement for this one to update the details of your court station. Okay, so check kung tama itong bank account ng STF and FF. Kasi kung mali ito, pag may na-deposit o collection sa maling account, it may be charged to your accountability. Okay, so dapat ma-check before mag-start ang JEPS, the first thing you're going to do is to verify the bank accounts provided under your court station, under your name. Okay, so yung mga luma pa, so hindi pa na-updated yung pangalan, so inform us to update the names of the accountable officers. So, okay, dito sa Paranaque, hindi pa pala ito updated, so we're going to update this one. Okay, this is how you verify the bank accounts, your court stations.
Okay, so number 5 from the guidelines, the manner of payment provided in OCAS Circular number 164. Yung 164 2020, nung inisyo natin to nung pandemic na pwedeng mag-bank transfer, online payment, sa kahit saang branches ng land bank. So, hindi nagagamitin yan. So, ito ng JEPS payment. Okay, i-stop natin yan. So, yung sa first level, pinapa-stop din yung payment ng small claims through FortunePay app. So, ang FortunePay kasama na sa loob ng JEPS. Okay, that's why. So, yung number 6 sa guidelines for court stations under the e-court case management system, the assessment and payment process provided in the court system shall be disregarded. So, hindi na dadaan sa assessment, collection, yung two stages, the direction na sa docketing ng case. Ay, pag-i-court kayo. So number 7, after payment, ang litigant magsasubmit siya ng PDF copy ng pleadings. Sasubmit sa inyo yan. Then po-provide nyo naman kami ng copy noon, ng pleadings na yon. So may file format yon yung sinabi ko. Naka, yan, R11 kung anong region, tapos yung court code, tapos JEPS OR number. Tapos pag in-email nyo, ang subject dapat ganito, pleadings for JEPS, para naka-filter yan dun sa amin. Hindi masasama yan sa mga reports and queries na sinasubmit nyo sa amin. Okay. So yung concerned COC, ACOC, yun nga, pag pinresent ng party yung proof of payment, so minsan naka-screenshot sa cellphone, so you're going to get the assessment number. I-input nyo yan doon sa administrator portal para i-verify yung payment kung tag as paid ba. So pag tag as paid, paano nyo i-verify yung collections na naggawa sa JEPS doon sa reports na ibibigay ng UBP. So ito, I prepared another video tutorial kung paano nyo i-confirm yung sa UBP collections and remittance report and paano yung makikita as tag as paid. Okay? So, sunod pa lang slide to. So, upon confirmation, yung payment verified portion, so na confirm nyo na yung payment, halimbawa. Okay, so you saw the payment doon sa admin portal and it's tag as paid. So magpiprint na kayo ng OR. Kayo ang magpiprint. Ha? Hindi nyo i-require yung party nagprint ng OR. So kung ipiprint pa, so Attorney Andrew suggested na madi-defeat yung purpose kung i-require pa natin ng party na magprint ng OR. So nag-online payment na sila, all they have to do is to present the copy of the OR. Kung nasa cellphone nyo, naka-screenshot, so you just get the assessment number and search it in the admin portal, okay? So, how to verify? So, COC shall verify the amount paid by the litigant. Correct, payment is insufficient. So, yun nga, pag pinresent yung OR, dapat check nyo yung pleadings niya, compare nyo sa pleadings, and yung nilagay niyang in-input niyang amount involved doon sa matcha-search niyo doon sa admin portal kung kulang ba, in-understate niya yung nilagay niya doon sa assessment. So, dapat naka-fully paid yon. So, paid ang nakatag doon. Pag partially paid, hindi pwede. Kailangan na magbayad ulit. So, pag partially paid, ibig sabihin kulang yung binayad. Okay. So, ito yung pag-verify kapag may overpayment naman nangyari, pag sobra yung binayad, so ang bill lang is 4,100 lang, pero nag-manual payment siya, gumamit siya ng GCash. Ang GCash kasi hindi nag-work yung QR code. Pag GCash na gamitin nyo, i-input nyo manually yung account name and account number and amount. So yung naging the problem na nag-encounter ng mga parties, namamali yung pag-input ng amount. Minsan kulang, minsan sobra. So kung sobra yung na-input, sa JDF papasok yung sobra. Pero pag kulang, magtatag as partially paid yung assessment, yung payment. Yung OR na ilalabas is partial payment lang. So hindi pa valid, hindi niyo pa pwedeng dakit yung case noon kasi partial payment. Kailangan bayaran yung kulang pa. Usually nagiging kulang noon, hindi nila na isasama yung service charge na 25 pesos. Kaya nabawasan na ng 25, pag magbabayad ulit sila, kailangan mag 50 pesos na yung bayaran nila kasi another service charge pag nag-process ulit sila ng another payment. Okay? So, kung may erroneous payment, different station, so kailangan magbahalba, nagkamali ng choose ng court station yung party, mali yung instead na Manila, so Quezon City ang na-choose niya doon sa drop-down. So magbabayad uli siya para doon sa Manila dapat, kung sa Manila siya dapat talaga mag-file. Yung sa Quezon City na ibayad niya, i-request niya for refund yun. Sino mag-endorse ng erroneous payment? Yung Manila, doon kasi siya nagpa-file talaga. So endorse niya sa FMO yung request for refund niya. Okay? So si yan, you should assist. Ito yung sinasabi ko, i-assist niyo yung party kung we are expecting talaga na parties hindi familiar din sa JEPS. So dapat kayo yung maging unang familiar sa JEPS. So explain nyo ano different options. Yung huwag nyo sabihin ng pangit yung JEPS talaga dahil may bayad. So you have to encourage din naman sila na there is another option na libre, may convenience pay na free. Okay. The concern si OC shall on a daily basis. Ito yung sinasabi ko pala, may tutorial video ako dito how to compare yung remittance report and collections report doon sa Indalo para malaman nyo kung remitted ba ng Union Bank and paano natag as paid. Okay. Next video.
Okay, I'll show you the remittance reports and collections reports that the Union Bank is sending to us. So they are sending those reports to our PJ365 accounts. So ini-email nila. So we're going to check the inbox of our Outlook. Okay? So open yung Outlook nyo. So I'm using Microsoft Edge. Dito ko rin sinign in yung Outlook, yung PJ365 ko sa Outlook app dito sa Microsoft Edge. So and I filtered the my emails, ha? I provided a separate folder for the Union Bank. So lahat ng sinesend ng Union Bank, dito papasok. Okay, so ito yung email ng Union Bank sending the collections report. Ito yung tinatanong nyo a week ago na hindi nyo ma-open because may password. Okay, so tayo natin i-open. Okay, so give the password. Input the password. So, as you can see, marami, ha? Maraming cords dito sa tab. Naka-itemize dito per tab yung cord stations. Okay, this is the collections report ng Union Bank. So, you can identify your collection reports based doon sa cord code nyo. So, dapat alam mo yung cord code nyo, like ito. MTCC_BAC. So it is for Bacolod, MTCC Bacolod. Itong CBY or from of natanong nyo so, a week ago na hindi nyo.
Ito yung pag the report. So pag Supreme Court, ganito yung title niya. Supreme Court. So ito yung remittance report. Okay? Pag itong Philippine Judiciary, siya yun yung collections report. So, I downloaded na yung ano niyan, file.
Followed. So,
i-pass forward ko to, ha, para wala na tayong oras. So, dinownload ko na yung two folders na yan. So, paano nyo i-co-confirm yung payments? Okay?
Compare collections report. Then, yung remittance report per court yung remittance remittance report nila. Okay. So, check natin. The total natin. How do you check kung na-remit yan? So, kunin nyo yung total nito. Okay, 9,680. So, nung August 5, collect deposits. Okay. So, yung collections, total nyo yung dalawang collections nito. Okay. Balance. Okay, so 9,680. So, tama. Ito yung collection.
So yan, pag na-check nyo na pareho naman yung ito yung may yellow, ito yung remittance report ng ito yung collections report ng UB, yung may mga code. Pag remittance report, isa-isa yung bigay ng Union Bank. So ito collections report yung may mga codes, so kailangan alam yung code niya. Okay? So yan yung pag-verify. Then yung kapag may discrepancy kayo nakita doon sa report, kailangan niyo i-provide dito sa forms na pinrovide namin para ma-identify natin kung ano yung discrepancy. So, yung may mga fields ako na-provide dyan, yung kailangan nyo lang ilagay yung kung anong number yun, kung anong date, para ma-submit natin sa Union Bank. Or you can send your problems, concerns doon sa group chat natin. So, added din naman yung Union Bank people doon para ma-assist tayo kung may mga discrepancy sa remittance and collections. Okay? So yung so pareho lang yon. So indicate the discrepancy sa monthly report. So pag may discrepancy, i-re-report nyo yun. I-disclose nyo sa financial month report. Then, pag nag-prepare kayo ng financial month report, yung CRR and CDR, so kasama yung pagko-combine nyo yung manual over-the-counter transactions and JEPS transactions. So, yung Attorney Hilda wants to reiterate itong circular na to 235/2018 na dapat private courier yung ginagamit nyo to submit your financial month reports kasi late nilang nare-receive yung mga reports nyo kung hindi kayo magpa-private courier. Okay. So, yung you can designate your cashier cash clerk para gumawa ng mga duties nun sa taas. Okay? Pero yung dapat, yung designation, approve ng EJ nyo. Okay? Then yung, ito yung requirement na parang we will launch yung mandatory implementation ng JEPS sa December 1. Kaya starting tomorrow, magawa na kayo ng notice din sa bulletin board nyo sa Windows na mag-JEPS transaction na kayo. Encourage the public to use JEPS, okay, sa in the payment assessment, payment and payment of legal fees and other court collections, okay? So ito yung sinasabi kong directive, that's why some RTCs here are present dito sa orientation na hindi part ng pilot courts ng 42 dahil required silang gumamit ng assessment ng JEPS microsite sa pag-assess ng legal fees, okay, para uniform na. Okay, ito yung web address. So, pero, and the circular mentioned also yung mga all presiding judges and COCs of the courts which have not opened the required bank accounts for the FF and SDF na magsusokos na sila pag wala pa sila hanggang ngayon. SDF, kasi kung wala pa silang SDF and FF, wala sila dito sa JEPS. Listahan. So, hindi sila makakapag-comply dito sa circular na gumamit ng JEPS. Okay? And ngayon, wala nang tayong time. Kung magko-Q&A, meron pang 10 minutes. Okay? Sorry, kasi hindi kami prepared. Biglaan tong seminar na to. Gusto kasi i-implement na tomorrow, kaya gumawa na lang kami ng way para magkaroon tayo ng ganitong orientation. So, hindi kami prepared ni Jason. So, pasensya na. Okay? Thank you. Wala tayong Q&A dito ngayon. Miss CJ. Sir Darwin, wala yung...
Hi, Sir Dex. Thank you for your, very detailed discussion about JEPS. Meron po tayong na-receive na questions sa ating Q&A in Microsoft Forms po. May anim po na questions. Teka, wait lang. Basahin ko lang po. So... yung first question po, may we have a soft copy of the rules in the lectures?
Okay. And,
yes, pa. Go ahead, sir. Next.
So the lecture materials will be provided on sa channel. So per region channels, we provided where we upload video tutorials. So doon din namin i-upload to.
All right. Next question po, Sir Dex. Why is the COC required to submit the PDF form of the complaint or pleading? The party should be the one required to do that. It will take so much of our time and we still have a lot of other things to do.
Oh, yes. Kasi if you're going to require the party, kasi we're just starting to implement the JEPS, parang hindi sila may encourage ngayon gumamit ng JEPS kasi ang daming trabaho ang gagawin. So that's why we're adjusting pa or what's the right thing to do para ma-encourage yung public to use the JEPS. If we're going to burden them to provide pa yung PDF file, kasi isasubmit na nila sa inyo yung PDF file eh. So the next step kasi ng JEPS is e-filing and you'll be required also to collate the PDF file copies of the pleadings. Kaya in preparation doon sa e-filing, ginagawa natin muna to. So, hindi muna natin bibigyan ng burden yung magsasubmit na kasi yung party sa inyo. So, kayo na lang mag-email sa amin.
Alright. Thank you. So, Sir Dex, meron pa pong isa. In situation where the party understated in their petition and the OCC demanded them to pay for additional docket fee, must we wait for an order of the judge to pay the additional fees?
No, hindi na. So yun nga, that one of your responsibility here as mentioned in the circular to be posted tomorrow, na you have to check whether the fees paid by the party are sufficient. So how to do that? You're going to check the pleadings they're going to submit and the assessment number that you will get doon sa proof of payment na makikita mm-hmm. nyo sa JEPS admin portal. So pag nakita nyo sa pleading sa prayer, 100, mm-hmm. may 1 million yon, so na-understate, 100,000 naligay or hindi in-input yung ibang prayer doon sa na amount. So yun, you can require them to pay additional the deficiency. So no need for the order from the court.
All right. Sir Dex, next question. May the party filing a case ask the OCC cashier to personally input the details in the JEPS microsite for assessment of filing fees?
Yes, oo. Pwede yan. Gawin. Mm-hmm. So, ginagawa na yun ng ating pilot court.
Assisted filing.
Yes, assisted filing.
Apo. So, may question po ulit. Annulment of title is a real action. What if the litigant classified it as an action incapable of pecuniary estimation? How to correct it? How yes. do we correct it?
Yun yung case. If you can't convince the party that it's a real action and they going to insist that, so you don't have, you have no choice. So, pero inunote nyo yan sa para sa inyo, it's a real action. So, pwedeng ma-technical yan, i-dismiss ng court yan pag talagang real action. So, there are cases na dinidismiss ng court for walang jurisdiction na yun dahil hindi real action, incapable yung. So, na-technical yung ganyang case. So, wala kayong magagawa kung ayaw talaga pumayag ng party na i-correct. So, just put a notation there doon sa assessment na it's a real action na the party paid only fee for incapable. So, idadakit nyo as incapable yan. Hindi real action. Ay, makikita ng judge yan pag na-raffle, bakit incapable to? Real action. So, pwedeng ma-dismiss yung case. So, inform yung party na gano'n ang mangyayari.
Okay. Next question po. Are annexes to the complaint or petition included on the copies that we are going to send via email?
Yung copy ng?
Sorry, yung annexes to the complaints daw po ba? Kasama daw po ba siya sa isa-send via email?
Hindi na. Basta yung pleadings lang. So, doon lang kami mag... Pag, yung para sa amin, doon lang kami sa pleadings titingin. No need for the annexes.
Okay. Meron pa pong question. What if the party or accused paying the cash bond has no email address? Will the OTP be automatically sent to the mobile number?
No, kasi laging sa email ad. So, yung suggestion ng isang sa first level court, can they provide na yung email na meron silang naka-reading email sa court? Mm-hmm. Kayo, pwede kayo maghanda ng isang email na hindi nyo ginagamit. Kung wala yung party, use that email para pag na-send, matatanggap nyo yung OTP. You can give the OTP number doon sa party. So, importanteng may email address. Correct. So, hindi magtutuloy sa online payment kung walang email address.
Okay. Sir Dex, ito pang 7 na question. What will happen if the court user already paid the fees but is not entitled to secure a copy of the documents? For example, he or she is not a party to the case or the document being requested.
Hindi na. So, depende yan sa inyo kung bibigyan nyo ba sila, kung hindi sila party. So, hindi namin kaya sagutin siguro yun. Sa Attorney Drew, mayroon ka bang dadagdag dun, sir?
I'm sorry, what was the question again, Sir Dex?
Apo, CJ, please read.
What will happen if the court user already paid the fees but is not entitled to secure a copy of the documents? Example, he or she is not a party to the case or the document being requested. So may nag-request na hindi pala siya yung may-ari or wala siyang sa document.
Pwede ba sir bigyan ng party ng copy siya yung party na yan hindi
definitely the person who is not a party to the case will not be provided with a copy of a court record, specifically if it pertains to a pending case in court. So, most likely, yung babayaran yan. Babayaran na lang siya niya yung extra.
Babalik na lang po yung bayad. Okay.
Yes.
Sir, ito pa, may question pa. Pero related to sa kanina eh. What if the litigants don't have email addresses and in fact, we will be the one to input the case details? Can we designate an email address for this so we can access the reference numbers, etc.? Thank you.
Yeah, so ayun nga yung what I answered. So pwede yun. So kung gusto nyo kayo mag-provide ng email ad, kay wala namang tayong mababiolate sa ng privacy doon. So yung OTP lang ang importanteng ma-receive. Pwede pong gawin. Thank you.
Okay, maraming salamat po sa lahat po ng nagtanong. Che-check ko lang dito sa ating Viber chat kung meron pang additional questions. Ayan. So far wala naman po. Wala na naman po Sir Dex, pero sa mga participants po natin galing sa second level courts, if you have additional questions or comments, kindly post them na lang sa ating Viber channel. Okay, meron po tayong Viber GC, pwede po nating i-post doon ang ating mga questions or suggestions or comments regarding sa JEPS utilization, no? Sir Dex, kailan po ulit yung implementation nito sa RTC?
So, magiging mandatory sa December 1. Kay tomorrow, ang start optional tomorrow hanggang November 30.
Okay. All right. So, Sir Dex, so far meron pa po ba kayong i-discuss with our attendees?
Nana, okay. I'm done. Thank you.
Maraming salamat po. I guess this is it. In-extend ba ni Sir Darwin yung meeting natin? Kanina nag-aano na siya ng 5 minutes left. Alright, maraming salamat po sa lahat po nag-attend ngayong hapon na ito sa ating online orientation seminar for the use of Judiciary Electronic Payment Solution or JEPS for the courts. If you have questions, additional comments or suggestions, post nyo lang po sa Viber. Nandito po ang ating mga auditors and tech support from MISO, auditors from the office of Sir Dexter Oca CMO and our tech support from the MISO. Maraming salamat po Sir Dex for your time and expertise, Sir Jason, and of course sa ating support na nasa likod lang po ng ating Teams channel, Sir Darwin, Sir Aaron, Sir Jovi, maraming salamat po. On behalf of Attorney Judge Sherwin Uy, he sends his regards and hopefully one of our future orientations or seminars makasama po siya. He sends his regards to everyone. Maraming salamat. Stay safe and God bless po.
Thank you. So may pahabol pala.
May pahabol for
Sharia courts. So we're going to conduct a separate orientation for Sharia courts kasi hindi masyado na-cover yung Sharia courts. Okay, mag-a-announce na lang kami. So Sir Jay is creating a separate GC for the Sharia courts. So we're going to post the announcement then when the orientation would be. Okay, thank you.
Okay po. Salamat po. See you then po. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, auditor. Thank you, Attorney Andrew.